Tag TV brings you daily news bulletin from India. Breaking news and views from India.
Good evening. Welcome to South Asia Newsline. I'm Yeshi Chansom. Here are the top stories we are tracking for you on Wednesday, the 14th of October. Residents face breathing problems as smoke returns to Indian capital. MQM founder says Pakistan is not a democracy but a stratocracy. And US envoy says violence in Afghanistan not consistent with Doha agreement. And now for all the details. Residents in New Delhi complained they were facing breathing difficulties as the air quality index remained in the unhealthy category in the Indian capital on Wednesday. Apart from increasing incidents of farm residue burning in neighboring states, the onset of winter and calmer winds have worsened the accumulation of particulate matter and pollutant gases in Delhi air.
Residents in Indian capital New Delhi on Wednesday said they were facing breathing difficulties due to the deteriorating air quality in the city as wind died down just as the burning of crop waste in fields sent smoke billowing across the north of the country. A smoggy haze settled over the national capital, reducing visibility as AQI, the air quality index, remained in the unhealthy category at 183. On Tuesday, New Delhi's air quality had hit an 8-month low with AQI levels at 306. An AQI between 0 and 50 is considered good, 51 and 100 moderate, 101 to 200 unhealthy, 201 to 300 poor, and 301 and higher is hazardous. Up until September, New Delhi and its satellite cities, which last year accounted for half of the dozen most polluted cities worldwide, had enjoyed respite due to a strict lockdown to stem coronavirus spread.
और जो पराली जल रही है धान की वो तो ये दिल्ली में धीरे धीरे एंटर कर रहा है जिसमें हमें सांस लेने में और बच्चों को भी मतलब जो गर्मी का फीलिंग आती है उससे बिल्कुल क्लियरली हमें पता चल जाएगी पराली जल रही है जिससे पोल्यूशन लेवल बहुत हाई हो रहा है और साइकिल चलाने में और सांस लेने में हमें बड़ी प्रॉब्लम होती है इस चीज़ से.
एवरी विंटर अ थिक ब्लैंकेट ऑफ स्मॉग सेटल्स ओवर नॉर्दर्न इंडिया एज अ कॉम्बिनेशन ऑफ फैक्टर्स सच एज द बर्निंग ऑफ स्टबल इन फील्ड्स इंडस्ट्रियल एमिशंस एंड व्हीकल एग्जॉस्ट व्हिच ब्रिंग अ स्पाइक इन पोल्यूशन.
Normal life has been thrown out of gear in Andhra Pradesh and Telangana after heavy rains lashed the two southern Indian states, which led to waterlogging and inundation of low-lying areas. More than 12 people have died in rain-related incidents in both the states. While rescue operations were underway, authorities in Hyderabad, home to major IT companies, declared a holiday on Wednesday and Thursday and asked residents to stay indoors.
Heavy rains have killed more than 12 people in southern India's Andhra Pradesh and Telangana states and caused widespread flooding in the Hyderabad city, home to major IT companies and startups, government officials said on Wednesday. A wall collapsed, killing 9 people in Hyderabad, the capital of the southern state of Telangana, while the other 3 were killed in separate incidents. Authorities in Hyderabad declared a holiday on Wednesday and Thursday and asked residents to stay indoors.
पब्लिक को हम लोग रेस्क्यू करने के लिए गवर्नमेंट की तरफ से ऑल इंतजाम किए गए. पब्लिक मैं रिक्वेस्ट करूंगा, आज कल भी बारिश बहुत बारिश है करके बोल रहे, तो सब लोग आप घर पे रहने के लिए मैं रिक्वेस्ट कर रहा हूं.
रेस्क्यू ऑफिशियल्स इवैक्यूएटेड सेवरल फैमिलीज फ्रॉम डिफरेंट लोकेलिटीज दैट वर फ्लडेड इवन एज रेस्क्यू एफर्ट्स वर अंडर वे इन मेनी अदर एरियाज. Meanwhile, according to India's weather office, heavy rainfalls are expected at isolated places over North Andhra Pradesh, South Interior Karnataka, South Odisha, South Chhattisgarh and Vidarbha. Parts of Western Maharashtra state are likely to witness heavy rains and thunderstorm for the next few days until October 15.
Moving on, Mutahida Qaumi Movement leader Altaf Hussain has said Pakistan is not a democracy but a stratocracy, where the army is ruling the country directly or indirectly and any criticism of it has been declared against the law. In a recent virtual address, he condemned the atrocities against Baloch, Sindhis and Mohajis in so-called military operations in recent years.
Mutahida Qaumi Movement or MQM founder Altaf Hussain has said Pakistan is not a democracy but a stratocracy where the army is ruling the country directly or indirectly and any criticism of it has been declared against the law. In a virtual address recently, Altaf Hussain said the Pakistan army has killed and displaced thousands of Baloch, Sindhis and Mohajirs in recent years and these incidents have increased manifold since the launch of projects as part of the China-Pakistan Economy Corridor.
And Islam Zindabad ke champion aaj bhi bane hue hain ye. Inhone lakh hazaron Balocho ka qatl kar diya, hazaron Sindhiyon ka qatl kar diya, Muhajiron ka qatl kar diya. Phir bhi dehshatgard Altaf Hussain.
The MQM leader also condemned Islamabad's move to launch new projects in islands neighboring Karachi city, backed by China, and termed it as an attempt to occupy the resources in Sindh province. Massive protests have rocked Sindh following the move by the Imran Khan government.
In news from Afghanistan, US envoy Ross Wilson has said that the current level of violence by the Taliban in Afghanistan is not consistent with the US-Taliban peace agreement and must stop. According to US-Taliban agreement signed in Doha in February, the militant group has committed to stop launching offensives on provincial capitals and major cities across Afghanistan.
United States envoy Ross Wilson has said that the current level of violence by the Taliban in Afghanistan is not consistent with the US-Taliban peace agreement and must stop. Wilson, taking to Twitter on Tuesday, said, "I strongly second General Miller's call for the Taliban to stop its offensive in Helmand and reduce its violence around the country." He asserted this violence, which is not consistent with the US-Taliban agreement, leads only to unacceptable loss of life and destruction. The remarks came as fighting continues in multiple areas in Afghanistan. And General Scott Miller, the US and NATO forces commander in Afghanistan, has called on the Taliban to immediately stop their offensive in Helmand. Under the US-Taliban agreement signed early this year, the militant group committed to stop launching offensives on provincial capitals and major cities. The Afghan government and other analysts maintain that the Taliban has increased attacks following the Doha agreement.
Moving on to news from Sri Lanka. Catholic leaders in Sri Lanka has urged the government not to proceed with the proposed 20th amendment to the constitution as the concentration of power in an individual without checks and balances does not augur well for a democratic socialist republic. The amendment, if passed, would bring parliament under the control of President Gotabaya Rajapaksa.
Sri Lanka's Catholic leaders urged the government on Tuesday not to proceed with the 20th amendment to the constitution that would consolidate power in the president's hands, saying it would undermine democracy. The Catholic Bishops' Conference of Sri Lanka said the government should concentrate instead on drafting a new constitution that will strengthen democracy, equality and the rule of law. The amendment, if passed, would bring parliament under the control of President Gotabaya Rajapaksa, who would have the power to dissolve the legislature, appoint top judges and have immunity against any prosecution. It would replace the 19th amendment, introduced in 2015, that curtailed the powers of the president and strengthened the role of parliament. The 20th amendment to the constitution was tabled in parliament by the government in September. A debate on it will take place in Parliament on October 20.
Moving on to news from Nepal. Nepal's government has lifted restrictions on public vehicles to ferry passengers to carry their full capacity. The decision comes despite the country recording spike in coronavirus cases daily.
At a time when COVID-19 cases are increasing rapidly in Nepal, the government has decided to lift restrictions on public vehicles to ferry passengers to their full capacity. The decision comes a month after it allowed long-haul buses to resume operations, 6 months after they were ordered to stay off the road as part of the efforts to contain the spread of the highly contagious coronavirus. Authorities then had given permission to ferry passengers equivalent to 50% of the sitting capacity of buses. Local authorities had even imposed the odd-even rule for the vehicular movement to curb the virus spread in Kathmandu. Meanwhile, confusion to Ren over the reopening of the country for tourists continues. In the latest, Nepal government has allowed foreign tourists only from mid-November, which supersedes its earlier decision to allow tourists in mid-October. With an uncontrollable rise in the number of COVID-19 cases in the last few weeks, the sector is doubtful if mid-November is a realistic target. As of Wednesday morning, the country reported 115,358 confirmed cases of the deadly virus and at least 663 deaths.
In news from Bangladesh, Bangladesh's cabinet early this week approved the capital punishment for rapists after seeing a surge of sexual crimes in recent years. Following the decision, residents in capital Dhaka on Tuesday came out onto the streets to extend their support. Residents in Bangladesh's capital Dhaka on Tuesday came out in support of a decision by the government to implement the death penalty for rapists in the wake of a series of gang rapes and sexual assaults. Bangladesh's cabinet on Monday approved the capital punishment for rapists after seeing a surge of sexual crimes in recent years. Nearly 1,000 incidents were reported between January and September, with more than a fifth of them being gang rapes, according to human rights group Ain Osalish Kendra.
গতকাল ধর্ষণের বিরুদ্ধে যে মৃত্যুদণ্ড কার্যকর হয়েছে আইন, সেটা যেন খুব দ্রুত কার্যকর হয়। একটা ধর্ষক যেন খুব দ্রুত তাকে শাস্তির আয়তায় আনতে পারে আমরা, এটাই আমাদের চাওয়া এখন।
Experts, however, said tougher penalties would not be enough to tackle the problem and authorities needed to immediately address systematic problems in rape trials and the extremely low conviction rates. The latest outpouring of national anger was sparked by a video of a group of men stripping and attacking a woman for almost half an hour in the southeastern district of Noakhali. Busa Krishna, an Indian fan of Donald Trump who worshipped the US president like a god, died of cardiac arrest over the past weekend. His family said he was depressed ever since he learned that the US president contracted COVID-19 recently.
An Indian man who worshipped Donald Trump and was upset by the news of the US president contracting COVID-19 died of a cardiac arrest over the past weekend. Busa Krishna, who had said his devotion for Trump had begun more than 4 years ago when the leader appeared to him in a dream, had days ago posted a tearful video on his Facebook page wishing for his idol's recovery from the deadly disease that has killed more than 1 million people worldwide. Krishna used to stuck Trump's photographs across the walls in his home and even wore t-shirts imprinted with his idol's images. The 33-year-old had spent 200,000 rupees and erected a 6 feet tall statue of Trump at his home.
ట్రంప్కు కరోనా వచ్చిందని తెలిసి వాడు చాలా బాధతోటి డోర్లు పెట్టుకొని రూములు ఉండి సరిగా అన్నం తినకపోవడం, నిద్రపోకపోవడం, ఏడ్చడం ఇట్లా చేసిండు. ఇట్లా చేసినాక మంగళవారం 11 గంటలకు లేచి ముఖం కట్టుకొని చా తాగిండు. చా తాగితే తాగుతానే పడిపోయిండు. పడిపోగానే ఏంది బిడ్డ అని అంటేనే ఉన్నా, మాట్లాడలేదు. మాట్లాడకపోయారు. డాక్టర్ని పిలిచినాం. డాక్టర్ మా అల్లుళ్ళు వచ్చిండ్రు, మా తమ్ముళ్ళు వచ్చిండ్రు, అందరు వచ్చి డాక్టర్ దగ్గర తీసుకుపోయినారు. అప్పటికే చనిపోయినయ్యా, ఈ బీకర్తో చనిపోయాడు. ఏం లేదు మనకి, ఏం ఇవ్వట్లేదు. అంతే అదే డౌట్ పెట్టుకున్నాడు ఆ కొడుకు. అటోటాక్ వచ్చి
ట్రంప్ రివీల్డ్ ఆన్ October 2 దట్ హీ హ్యాడ్ టెస్టెడ్ పాజిటివ్ ఫర్ COVID-19 అండ్ స్పెండ్ 3 నైట్స్ ఇన్ ది హాస్పిటల్ ఫర్ ట్రీట్మెంట్. హీ సెడ్ ఆన్ సండే హీ హ్యాడ్ ఫుల్లీ రికవర్డ్ and is about to resume campaigning ahead of the November 3 US election.
Well, that's all we have for you from South Asia this evening. Now our viewers can watch the show on southasianewsline.com. You can also visit us on facebook.com/asianewsline and follow us on Twitter at asianewsline. That's all in tonight's edition. We'll see you same time tomorrow. Good night.
Subscribe Tag TV YouTube channel and press the notification button. Subscribe Tag TV YouTube channel and press the notification button.